Entertainment to RBN Sports Studios for Sports First. I'm Gabrielle Amato. This is Drake Cordero, and today is National Grouch Day. So we're going to have a little bit of fun. Dre, let's think of some players that would fit into National Grouch Day.
Yeah, so Pepe immediately.
100%.
Diego Costa, absolutely.
Fabio Quintrao, I feel like is a little bit of a grouch, like a grump, like hard to get out of bed in the morning, doesn't want to go to training.
Who's coaching the team?
Jose Mourinho. Or also like maybe like a Luis Enrique also I feel like he's like a little grouchy.
Absolutely.
Maybe like assistant coach.
Right now we could probably just plug in all of Manchester United.
Yes.
Just straight into the grouch team.
Absolutely. No, what a fun day. Well, you guys let us know who you think should be in the National Grouch team and we'll see if we agree with you. But today we're going to talk about the biggest, baddest United States national team as they booked their ticket to the 2019 World Cup.
Yep.
Then we take a look at an injury crisis brewing in Barcelona. Oh, and the Icardi to Real Madrid rumors are back. And then what coulda, shoulda, woulda happened had Lopetegui not done the whole, you know, Spain saga. We chat about it all on Sports Burst that starts now. The U.S. women's national team are going to France. The Stars and Stripes have booked their ticket to the World Cup 2019 after an absolutely outstanding qualifying campaign. They have once again proven they are the best national sports team this country has to offer. But what more do they have to do, Dre, to get the respect they deserve?
I don't know that you can do much more historically than they have done. By the way, congrats to both the U.S. and Canada. Both qualify for the World Cup by virtue of reaching the CONCACAF final, where they'll play head-to-head. Two more goals by Alex Morgan. Two goals by Tobin Heath as well. I think they did a terrific job in qualifying. It was never going to be in doubt, obviously. I think maybe it's a bigger story that Canada have been as good as they have been. They thumped Panama 7-0, while the U.S. won 6-0. Those two teams will play in the final Wednesday at Toyota Stadium. We got to talk to the bosses to see if they'll send us out.
Yeah, please.
To cover these things.
Tickets,
so
just if they're watching, Dre and I.
Yeah, first class is fine. If not, you know, we'll do what we can. But congrats to the U.S. I don't think it was ever a question as to whether they would qualify. I think they're obviously going to be the favorites to win the CONCACAF tournament as well. And then we'll see if they can claim another World Cup title in France.
But the sheer way that they did it, I guess, shows just how dominant they are. But there's still questions, you know, they qualify for the World Cup, but there's still some controversy surrounding this World Cup and decisions that FIFA has made. For example, there's going to be no VAR at this World Cup. Why do you think that they would put it in for the men's game, but not give the women the same?
I think it's still too often, it speaks horribly of FIFA, that it's still too often an afterthought, the women's game. There's absolutely no excuse and no reason not to have VAR. And for me, VAR is one of those things where now that it's a thing, now that the Men's World Cup has it, La Liga, Serie A, Ligue 1, all use VAR, it looks sort of odd to not have it, especially at a major global event like this.
Absolutely.
Where they're playing at Ligue 1 stadiums that are already using VAR on a league basis. So I don't get at all why a women's game would not use it. The one thing, though, is women's football can be vicious. And I think with VAR, you're going to see a lot more red cards in women's football.
Absolutely. And then another thing to point out is that the World Cup women's final, the Gold Cup final, and the Copa America final are all on July 7th of next year.
All the same day.
All on the same day.
That's nonsense.
Why not give the women their own day for a final?
Yeah, that's a mistake by FIFA. It's a mistake by CONCACAF. By the way, CONCACAF does this all the time in terms of scheduling. And they might not be at fault here. I haven't looked at exactly what went into the scheduling. But how often do you see the men's national team playing on a day when Major League Soccer is still playing and the league won't suspend, and CONCACAF scheduling is an absolute mess. I'm disappointed that all three of those finals are the same day. It's disrespectful, I think, to all three tournaments.
Absolutely. Let's hit the comments here just quickly. Lance Pimentel saying equal rights. We're with you, Lance. Yes, we want that too. A lot of people saying hello to us. Franklin Moore saying I'm proud of them. I'm sure they will win the World Cup. We hope so too. Yep. So now things are going really well for the U.S. women's national team, but things are not going so hot for Barcelona back in our league. We are hitting the Barcelona crisis button right now. It's like a major, major issue. Vermaelen has been ruled out now for 6 weeks with a thigh injury. This after Umtiti has been ruled out with his own injury to the knee indefinitely, leaving just Piqué and Longley as Valverde's remaining center back options. Should Barcelona fans be concerned, right? This is
so,
like a little bit of a problem.
Yes, they should. And if you allow me, I'm going to go on a little bit of a tangent. We're going to talk about this injury situation, but I want to first talk about the word crisis, right? Because right before the international break, Real Madrid are in a crisis, the first crisis of the season. Now, coming out of the international break, Vermaelen's injured. There's a real, you know, injury concern at Barcelona, crisis for Barcelona. And I fear that we're turning in football, not just us, but the entire footballing media has turned Real Madrid and Barcelona's faux crises into breaking news, right? So you watch any news network and all day it's breaking news, breaking news. It's not actually breaking news, it's just news. It's not actually breaking at the moment. It happened at 6 o'clock in the morning and you're covering it at 8 p.m. at night. It's not breaking news.
So this is actually just like old
this
news.
Is not an actual crisis. Neither of these teams are in a real crisis. They're first and second in La Liga. They're not as good as they've been in years past, but if they were 10th and 14th, I'm pressing the crisis button.
Okay.
They're not at the moment. Now, back to the actual
so
issue.
Is this a concern for Barcelona?
Yes, it is, because they've only got four healthy defenders going into an absolutely brutal week on the schedule. Thankfully for Barcelona, all three games are at home, but they'll play in succession from October 20th to the 28th against Sevilla, Inter, and Real Madrid. Back to back to back.
Yes.
With four defenders, right? Because Umtiti is still injured, and actually the news on him doesn't look all that great because they've been trying to take an approach that wouldn't require surgery. He's not evolving as quickly as they would like, so we might not actually see Samuel Umtiti back on the pitch for Barcelona until 2019, which means he would miss out this entire stretch. They're also without Sergio Roberto. His injury is not as serious. He should be back relatively soon. And now Vermaelen added to that list. He's going to be out for about 6 weeks, according to reports. So all Barcelona have to start against the likes of Sevilla and Inter, at least, and maybe even Real Madrid, are Lenglet and Piqué in the middle, Nelson Semedo and Jordi Alba. Any one of them gets hurt, and now you're using an emergency center back or somebody from the youth team, and that's not the ideal scenario for this stretch of games.
And this is, I mean, a Piqué that, I don't know about you, but I've seen him not at his strongest by far.
It might even be a fitness issue with Gerard Piqué following the World Cup. Obviously, he's retired from international football. He hasn't had a lot of rest over the years because of international and Barcelona playing every 3 days and across three competitions. So, yeah, Piqué is not at his best level. In fact, right now, if everyone was healthy, I think the best option in the center of defense would be Lenglet and Umtiti because of Piqué's form at the moment, and that's not a possibility.
Correct. And Sebastian Restrepo Diaz making a great point here, should have kept Yerry Mina.
Although,
should they have kept him as a backup?
He'd probably be injured right now the way things are going for Barcelona.
True. This is true.
It's not that they're short on defenders, it's that they're short on healthy defenders.
But why do you feel like a team gets hit with these kind of injuries? Is it the way that they warm up? Is it just so happens, a coincidence?
I don't know. Sometimes it's a scenario where maybe teams aren't training right or the conditioning is not right. That doesn't usually happen to teams like Barcelona or Real Madrid. I don't know behind the scenes why it's happening, whether it's a conditioning issue, whether it's a training thing.
Right.
But most often, and the most accessible explanation to us is bad luck.
And ironically, this is a Barcelona side that we all said bought really well over the summer, that they were really stacked, that they were very deeper than Real Madrid, and then this happened.
In midfield especially, right? Because they don't really have a second string center forward behind Luis Suarez. They can use a Dembele or a Messi as a second striker. They look thin at the moment at the back because of all of the injuries, but they're stacked in midfield. And speaking of stacked in midfield, I would not be surprised to see Arturo Vidal be used as an emergency center back should something happen to a Lenglet or a Piqué, or just to try something different. Under Marcelo Bielsa with the Chilean national team, Arturo Vidal played virtually every position. He did the same thing at Juve, where he played as a defensive midfielder, a side midfielder, a fullback, a center back. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Arturo Vidal, who is desperate for playing time.
That's where I was going to go. Someone who's been very vocal on social media about his desire to play. Would he be happy with that position?
I think he'd be happy to play. By the way, I'm not predicting this is going to happen. I'm just saying this is a possibility for an Estevan.
No, it's a solid possibility. Ruben Lopez saying Vermaelen has crystal legs. Does Gareth Bale.
It's not a surprise really that Vermaelen is injured, right?
No.
So when that happens, it's like, okay, well, of course that's going to happen because Vermaelen is almost always injured.
And the last one on this topic, Ujwal Gajural saying Barcelona defenders falling like dominoes. Yikes. It's not a good look for Valverde. Yeah. But over to Real Madrid, the Icardi to Real Madrid rumors are back, this time with Fabio Capello adding to this fire, telling Radio Rai of Italy, quote, "If I was Real Madrid, I would sign him immediately. He's a specialist in the penalty area like Cristiano Ronaldo was during his later time at Madrid." Is Icardi what Real Madrid need, Dre?
Unequivocally, yes. I think absolutely Mauro Icardi would be an ideal center forward for Real Madrid. They would have to break the bank for him. I think there's something like a 100 million euro buyout clause or something like that for teams outside of Italy to sign him. That might have even gone up, actually, since last I checked. But Icardi is a guy who guarantees you goals. He's not always going to be the most involved in play. He's not going to drop back into the midfield quite as often as you would like to get a touch in there. But Real Madrid have plenty of playmakers, have plenty of guys who can get the ball to a center forward who can score goals, and Icardi is exactly that. Much more accomplished, much further along in his career than like a Mariano Diaz, for example. So you get a proven goal scorer who's already won the scoring title in Serie A twice in his career, who's still relatively young and can play for a decade at Real Madrid. I think it would be a no-brainer, and Real Madrid have the money to do it. So.
And that's essentially exactly what they need. They don't need the playmaker. They just need the person who's going to finish it off in the box, something that Benzema, Bale are not doing.
Sure. And I think actually you'd see more production out of Benzema if he had a center forward he can sort of help create for, like he did with Cristiano Ronaldo when he was coming in from the wing. Late in Cristiano Ronaldo's career, the last couple of seasons, we've seen as the year goes on, he becomes much more of a center forward. He's not always starting off from the wing as he was earlier in his career, covering a lot more ground. And so that seems to be the piece that is most missing right now for Real Madrid, is that guy up top that put goals in. That's Mauro Icardi.
And exactly as Fabio Capello said, he does have similarities in that sense to Ronaldo, and maybe he is a good buy. Maybe they can pick him up in the January transfer window, because UEFA did change the rules in that they can play for the Champions League for a different team.
Is that
even
right?
If they, yes, the new rule. Before, it was, you know, complicated, especially when Coutinho came, for example. You couldn't play in the Champions League with Barcelona because he had featured for Liverpool. But now the rules have changed, and now Icardi would be able to play for Real Madrid in the Champions League.
I'm not sure that I like that.
Really?
Well, not in this particular case. I think it'd be great for Real Madrid if they get Icardi and he can play even though he's played for Inter in the Champions League. But I don't like the idea that you start playing
for
one team in that competition, and maybe that team gets knocked out in the group stages, and you move on to another team that's in the knockout stages. I'm not sure I like this.
Trading in teams. Yeah. But Sergio Ramos has been very vocal about his, praising Harry Kane, saying that Harry Kane would be maybe a great fit in La Liga. How do you feel about that?
If I'm Real Madrid, I'd rather have Mauro Icardi than Harry Kane. For starters, I think Harry Kane would be more expensive. I don't know why English Premier League players are so expensive, especially within the Premier League. It wouldn't be the case here because he'd be moving into La Liga, but he's going to Real Madrid, so they know that he would need him. They would ask for even more money. He'd be a terrific choice, but if I had to pick between the two, between Harry Kane or Mauro Icardi, I'm taking Icardi.
I am also. And Andres agreeing with you that that's a bad change of rules.
He
also does not like that rule. Ray Ray saying Zidane left. Hi, Ray Ray. You're always around. Zidane left at the right time. He saw all of this coming. Maybe he saw all of this coming. I think he saw that maybe there was going to be a transitional period for Real Madrid, and he's like, I just don't want to be part of this project.
I think that's what he means by he saw this coming.
So maybe you're right.
And if you've already won three consecutive Champions Leagues, but that third season you finished third in La Liga, you're maybe worried that the league form is more of an indication of who you are than the Champions League, where you can get hot at the right time or, the right bounce of the ball in the semifinal. And I'm not saying that it was luck that they won, but basically it is a bit more circumstantial than in a league campaign where you have to play 38 games. I mean, there were hints there that Madrid were going to have to move on, change the team up a little bit. Cristiano Ronaldo was certainly flirting with the idea of leaving. Benzema
publicly
is getting up there in ages. Players like Luka Modric, also above 30 years old, and even Inter was trying to lure him away. So Zidane left at the right time. I'm not sure that seeing it coming, no, he just knew it was going to require a restructuring, and that wasn't the case when Zidane took over. When Zidane took over, the team was already built, and all he had to do was manage it.
Right.
Now he was going to have to rebuild it. I don't think he wanted that task.
Angel Najera saying, we need Hazard. And this is another name that's been thrown around.
I'm guessing he's a Real Madrid fan.
Probably, right, Angel.
Okay. By the
we're
we,
reading that, yes.
Sure.
Exactly. Yeah. Hazard, obviously a name that's linked to Real Madrid transfer season after transfer season. Do you think that it'll eventually happen?
He's blowing kisses at Real Madrid too, right? In the media,
the flirting is unbelievable, Hazard.
Right. So
like, get a room.
Yeah, he's batting his eyelids at Florentino Perez. I think
please
he'd be a terrific... Listen, we're talking about elite players. For me, the definition of a world-class player, which I consider Icardi, Harry Kane, Eden Hazard, for me, world-class means I can pluck you out of your team and put you into any club in the world and you will start. Not you can come off the bench, you can be at Real Madrid at the Bernabeu, you can start. I think Hazard could start at Real Madrid. Icardi could start at Real Madrid. Harry Kane could start at Real Madrid. These players would play virtually anywhere. They're at that elite level.
Absolutely. And this is obviously all Julen Lopetegui's problem. And let's play a little game of shoulda, coulda, woulda, Dre.
Okay.
So, Spain are under a perfect start under Luis Enrique. 3 wins from 3 matches post-World Cup, causing us to wonder, is this really Luis Enrique's doing? Or if Lopetegui to Real Madrid didn't happen, would Spain have won the World Cup?
I don't
follow. It's a little bit of a crazy thesis, but our producer was behind it, so we're going to throw it out.
You just threw him under the bus because you, you basically...
No,
you
know. Because I guess what they're saying is this Luis Enrique making the Spain side perfect, or is this just stability with a manager and then the Spain side are kind of forming themselves and, so, and getting it all together?
I think after Lopetegui, a change was going to be needed. So a change in the mentality of the team, a change in intensity, and I think Luis Enrique brings that to the table. And so often when you have a new manager and players are eager to impress and they're fighting for playing time, that'll have sort of a positive, at least in the short term, will have a positive impact. I don't know that if we don't have the Lopetegui saga before the World Cup, two days before Spain kick off the World Cup campaign, that they necessarily go out and win the whole thing. In fact, I think if you replay the game against Russia with the same players and the same manager, it's a good chance that Spain actually win that game 8-9 times out of 10. Russia were terrific, took it all the way to penalties, and that's how they sorted it out. So I don't know. I think it's sort of inconsequential whether it was Lopetegui or Luis Enrique or Fernando Hierro who was managing the team at the moment.
Right.
The bottom line is it was not the ideal scenario to fire your coach 2 days before the World Cup.
No, and it obviously does have implications that we saw. Just like you said, it's like a shoulda, coulda, woulda situation. We don't know what would have happened, but you're saying no.
I don't think Spain... So are they good enough to have won the World Cup? Sure. Are they definitively the best team on the planet? And if they had their manager and everything was perfect, they would have won? No.
Right.
I still think Brazil and France are probably equal to or greater than Spain at the moment.
Let's hit this comment here because it's kind of interesting. Just going back to the Real Madrid topic. Sebastian Restrepo Diaz saying Real Madrid's potential front three, Hazard, Icardi, Bale. I feel like that's what you expect from a Real Madrid side.
It's fantasy football, right? Like, they haven't signed Galacticos in quite some time.
Right.
So this
would
certainly
be... You called it Galactico 3.0 project that maybe
that
we
would
see.
Right.
But we haven't seen it yet.
And that suggests to me that Lopetegui's a bit of a fall guy, that it's not a long-term thing. Because I think if it was long-term, they would have gone out and signed the replacement for Cristiano Ronaldo. I think Lopetegui saw... it's not that Zidane saw the writing on the wall. I think Florentino saw the writing on the wall and went with a manager that would be popular, but not necessarily long-term.
Well, a manager that is popular is Thierry Henry for Monaco. I think so. I think fans are going to be happy with that one. He had his first training session as Monaco manager today. They play Strasbourg on Saturday. What do we expect from Thierry Henry's Monaco?
I'm excited, but I'm worried.
Okay.
Because Monaco are an absolute mess.
Yes.
And they had a very good manager in Leonardo Jardim who saw season after season all of his best players get sold, replaced by potential but not actual reality. And he did it time and time again, finishing in the top three. It takes a special kind of manager to lose those sorts of players every single season and still continue to compete for the title, continue to qualify for the Champions League. When Thierry Henry was rumored to be going to Bordeaux, I thought that could be a disaster. Bordeaux are a mess. I don't know where the goals are going to come from. You know, granted, the opportunity wouldn't be there. Thierry Henry wouldn't be able to take it. But don't go there. Go somewhere where the team's more established. This is a worse scenario, I think, than Bordeaux was because the expectation is higher for Monaco than it is for Bordeaux. And the situation is worse. They've been plagued by injuries at the start of the season. They've not been able to replace the starters that they've sold over the last two seasons. And so right now they're threatened by relegation. You could see Thierry Henry start his managerial career by being either fired or relegated from a club he used to play for, and that's not a good look.
But maybe he'll save them from relegation, and it'll be a Cinderella story, and they'll win Liga next season under Thierry Henry.
And they'll all live happily ever
after. And the hashtag Zidane effect. Woo! And the NBA is back tonight. We know you're a big NBA guy.
I am.
What are your season predictions? How are you feeling?
I'm not feeling great for my Miami Heat.
Okay.
I'll tell you how not great I'm not feeling. I didn't renew my season tickets. So.
That's right.
Yeah, I don't have that much money anymore. So
the games start tomorrow. What are you, what do you expect out of the season? Not from aside from you being underwhelmed by your Miami.
I think at first it's going to be surreal to watch LeBron in a Lakers uniform.
Yes.
That's going to be a bit
the beginning of an era.
Strange, and then we can probably see him in the final again because that's what LeBron James does. He plays basketball and plays finals.
Des Norris here. I just have to go back to the Spain topic. The real victim is Jordi Alba.
Luis Enrique.
Des, we agree with you. Luis Enrique has a big X over poor Jordi Alba, who deserves that Spain spot, and he's just not getting it.
He's the best left back with a Spanish passport.
And
he doesn't even get called up.
The ticket, so that's that. Watch The Extra tonight, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, hosted by Kevin Egan. And then The Locker Room, hosted by this guy.
Yeah,
what are you guys going to be chatting about?
Well, it's a big international week that just passed by, right? So we're going to be talking about some of the big games that just passed. And we'll look ahead to the start of leagues getting on the way now on the 19th and the
20th. Breaking it all down. And then Monday Night Soccer with Georgie Metallus at 8. So tune in. And that's all we have time for Sports First today. We'll see you tomorrow.